A question that we all wonder about. I think that you have been very patient. It was 50 years between your proposal of existence with Hadron boson and the time it took us to find it. And machine builders and experimentalists, we wonder, what were your thoughts during those 50 years? Did you think we were totally incompetent?
Oh no! At the beginning in 1964, and in 1966, when I wrote the longer paper on the subject, what I had done was not truly a theory about anything in particular. It was a possible kind of theory which looked as if it had promise somewhere in the context of particle physics, but it wasn't clear where it should be. And for the first few years, most of us who were involved in that, and I should say there were many, many other people apart from me, I happen to be one of the lucky ones, we were all looking in the wrong part of particle physics, because the whole sort of ethos of particle theory at the time was that it was about hadrons. These leptons were, you know, well, there was an electron, and Pauli had predicted something which would go with the electron in order to conserve energy in beta decay, but leptons weren't taken seriously by most people. So we all tried to make the kind of spontaneously broken gauge theory that I'd written down, and which Robert Brout and François Englert had written out in more generalization as far as the masses of spin one particles are concerned. We looked in the wrong place, and the person who had the real insight and realized that this wasn't the right thing to do was Steve Weinberg. He suddenly realized, this was after we had met briefly at Brookhaven in the summer of 1967, and we were essentially working on the same sort of problem and having the same difficulties in slightly different languages. I was happy to be explicitly a field theorist, and that was out of fashion at the time. And Weinberg saw the light. His own words were something like, I've been applying the right ideas to the wrong problem. So Weinberg got it right. And after that, the question was, well, okay, if this is the theory of electroweak interactions, how do we find all these other particles which they have to be? And as far as the spin zero particle was concerned, the best guess was that it would be far too massive for any conceivable machine in my lifetime to reach in terms of energy. But then Weinberg, sometime later, did another smart thing. He found a way of looking at corrections to the simple theory, radiative corrections, and saying, well, if the spin zero massive particle were more than about around 1 TeV, then the symmetry breaking mechanism would not work this way. It was at that point that the possibility became realistic to think that I might be alive to see it done. But it was a colossal experimental program. I spent 2 months at CERN in the autumn of 1976, which was just a year after John Ellis Mary Kay Gaillard and Dmitry Nanopoulos had written their paper, Phenomenology of the Higgs Boson, in which they said we know so little about the numbers involved that we can't really tell you much, but we think that the experimentalists ought to keep their eyes open for it when they're looking for something else. So that alerted the experimenters, and then the rest of the story is the progress of the machine building, your story, because well, when I was there in 1976, LEP was being planned, and of course the LHC was being planned too, because the LEP tunnel was made big enough to take it, because it was not clear that LEP would be energetic enough, and you'd have to go to something bigger and better, namely the LHC. And so I was educated about the problems of doing the experiments and, well, the colliders that would be involved. And I kept careful watch on what was happening. And of course, the first thing that, significant thing that happened was that Carlo Rubbia jumped the gun with a little help from his friend Simon Pantemiro, and he had his anti-proton accumulator built for him, and bingo, the charged W plus and W minus were discovered, and that was useful information. It pinned down those particles. Then going back on the theoretical side, the way the theory works is that you have, in the language of Feynman diagrams, a tree approximation in Feynman diagrams, where you can really more or less read off what to do by looking at the classical field theory interactions and reading whatever textbook happens to be at hand, like Bjorkin on Drell telling you how to calculate an S matrix element. And when you do the radius of corrections one loop, then you find there's a sum rule involved, and the discrepancy from the primitive calculation, the so-called tree approximation, it has contributions from all the particles which in Feynman's language are called virtual. They've not been found yet, but they're on their way to being found. And if you know some of them, then you can say something about what else there ought to be. And first of all, you see there's a great discrepancy which ought to be the Z0, and okay, that eventually is found. And then what's left? The Higgs boson. So there's a discrepancy, and that tells you where the mass of the Higgs boson ought to be. But of course the experimental errors are big, and gradually the experimental errors get produced. And I watched that leftover gap shrink with great interest. And by the time that LEP had to close to make way for the next machine, and this of course caused a certain amount of trauma, because there were some people thought they'd got it already, it was clear that the LHC ought to get there. Yes. So after that, I just had to live a little longer.
So yes, we built the LHC so that we would, if the Higgs boson existed, you were perfectly convinced, but if the Higgs boson existed, we were bound, certain to find it.